Give me money, give me money, give me money, give me money, give me money.
One of the biggest hurdles in doing any kind of criticism and discussion on how not to write like an idiot is community perception. I've talked about it a fair bit, but here's a refresher. People get certain ideas in their head of how writing must always work, and they often refuse to deviate from it. Nuanced and complicated aspects of writing get boiled down to absolutist beliefs. The most pervasive of these is serialized storytelling versus episodic storytelling. Both of these methods of storytelling have their strengths and weaknesses, and if you understand that, then you can easily choose whichever fits your story the best. But in the age of Netflix, where binge-watching a season on the first day has become the norm, many people believe that a serialized story is automatically better than an episodic story in all cases, regardless of how the story actually plays out. This belief is simply not true, and it boils down complicated elements of storytelling to a simple, just do this and you automatically win. It's not an opinion so much as you're just wrong. Like, that's just not how writing works. Romantic subplots are subject to so many false beliefs and community perception that it has unfortunately crippled them in extremely horrible ways, as the tasteless forumites of yesteryear have grown up into the executive producers of today. Romantic subplots are one of the most universally complained about elements of modern shows, with criticisms ranging from the valid to the strange to the just fucking stupid. And because romance is one of my favorite genres, we're gonna go through how to make your romantic subplots better. Just cause I like you and I want you to stop sucking. So everyone knows that The Last Airbender and The Legend of Korra had absolutely terrible romantic subplots. Even people who love Korra admit that they're terrible. Why are they so bad, though? Well, the answer's pretty simple. They never actually start. Romantic subplots have their own arcs. Imagine, if you will, a conventional relationship where you get together, you start dating, you get engaged, you get married, you have a family, you settle down. And if you'll look over here at this very professional chart, you're probably already seeing the problem. The Legend of Korra and The Last Airbender never move past getting together. Characters take an entire season to get together, only to break up either partway through the next season, if not right in the middle. All the time spent between that is usually just dawdling around, teasing people, and constantly stitching characters together and breaking them up again. This is called the will-they-won't-they plot, and it's arguably the most popular type of romance out there. Will-they-won't-they had been around before, but it didn't get its massive popularity until the late 90s when a TV sitcom called Friends hit the airwaves. Friends was a sitcom about six friends and all their weird urban adventures between jobs, relationships, neighbors, and whatever the fuck Joey was doing this week. One of the most popular running stories was the relationship between Ross and Rachel, who were constantly getting together, breaking up, having fights, getting back together, breaking up again, going on and on and on for the entire 10-season run. In the very last episode, they got back together, presumably for good this time. It was really popular and became an omnipresent trope in sitcoms, cartoons, and films. Legend of Korra had it several times. The Last Airbender had it with Aang and Katara. Adventure Time had it with Marceline and Bubblegum. She-Ra and the Princesses of Power is doing it with Adora and Catra. Star vs. the Forces of Evil is doing it with Starco. It goes on and on. And on. Here's the problem. Will they, won't they is a fucking terrible story idea. In the case of modern cartoons, it only ever works by baiting fans. Fans tend to get really excited about their ships, and you can basically tease them with it in perpetuity for year after year after year. You're being strung along for as long as the writer thinks they can get away with it. Even if it's a straight pairing, writers are really timid and coy about actually pairing people together. They'll constantly write it in ways as to make fans think that they have to keep watching just to see if it goes anywhere. Keep watching and maybe you'll find out. Will they, won't they is also a trope with extremely toxic roots. The show that started the trope, Friends, has aged extremely badly over the years because the ship tease of Ross and Rachel was one of the main story arcs, and it suffers because Ross is a creepy, abusive stalker. He's low-key homophobic toward his ex-wife, he said someone else's name at his second wedding, he and Rachel got married in Vegas, and then when he was supposed to get an annulment, he refused to and kept it secret from her. He cheated on her and then spent the rest of the series insisting he did nothing wrong and making jokes about it. He repeatedly tried to manipulate Rachel into getting back together, and then in the final episode, he pressured her to give up a really good career opportunity for him, which she eventually caved. And this launched a very stubborn trope indeed. Let's go back to that very professional chart. You all love the chart, it's a lovely chart. You know all those cliche romantic subplots that you're so sick of? They never move past the first part here. Getting together is the prologue of a romantic subplot, and yet so many properties treat it like the end game. This is why there's so much focus on whether or not your characters have chemistry, because the getting together is the only part of a relationship where chemistry actually matters. People who have experiences with relationships are well aware of the fact that relationships quickly simmer down into something rather comfortable. This is why on the first date, you dress up nice and make yourself look presentable, while people who've been together for a year will slump on the couch watching Netflix and are just as comfortable calling that a date as they are a nice dinner out. Another problem romantic subplots have, or at least I'm told, is that they tend to make the characters involved being defined by their relationships. Female characters get this a lot, where if the story ends getting together with someone, then they're said to have been defined by who they ended up with. Defined by who they end up with has long been a nebulous concept at best, but there's a lot of arguing over what it actually means and how to solve it. The proposed solution to this is to have them remain perpetually single or pair them with that universe's Ross. But another, even better solution to that problem is don't end the story with them getting together. You know how in Harry Potter, the only reason Harry and Hermione never got together was because J.K. Rowling didn't want Hermione to be defined by whose arm candy she got to be? Well, the hard truth of that is Rowling was the only one who actually made it a problem that needed solving. Yeah, if Hermione got together with Harry, it would have boiled her down to Hero's girlfriend, ... If you did it in the Deathly Hallows, if you do it in the Goblet of Fire with 3.5 books left to go, you don't have this problem anymore because the relationship has time to simmer down and become the new norm in the eyes of the reader. Relationship starting is a big moment for any story, and if it's the last moment, then that's what the audience is going to remember most. They get defined by their relationships because placing this at the end signifies to the audience that this is the culmination of their character arcs. A character is only going to be defined by their relationship if you're the one who makes it the defining moment in the first place. You can probably already see where I'm going with this, so let's get right to it. You don't have to wait until the end of the story to pair characters together. It's not a rule, and in general, relationships are much more satisfying and engaging to read about if you actually write the part where there's a relationship. Hey, here's a crazy thought. You know you can write a story where people are already together before the story even starts, right? Just as a side note, one piece of writing advice that people ask me for a lot is how to establish that a character's gay without just having them unceremoniously say, "I'm gay." As somebody who's written over a dozen gay characters, the solution for me is pretty simple and obvious. When I want to establish that a character is gay, I introduce the audience to her wife. It's such an obvious solution to a non-issue, and yet nobody seems to ever think of it. The untapped potential and new stomping grounds created by this are almost infinite, and yet few people seem to want to take advantage of it. It's something I do a lot. I always write relationships that are either already established or establish themselves very quickly. My characters, they're forward, and if they have an interest in someone, there's no real beating around the bush. They just go ask them out. There are no issues regarding being defined by a relationship because it happens so quickly, and I establish it as the new normal. In fact, here's another example. Lizzie's been working on this fantasy story called Dark Magic. The spoiler-free version goes like this. A witch escapes from a walled-off area of the forest that's designed to keep witches out because they were dicks a long time ago and now has to live among people who hate and distrust her while fighting against the conflict which threatens humanity. One of the early story threads is the witch saving a princess because, haha, what are you gonna do with your life now, knights in shining armor, and the two become best buds. Now, as Lizzie's been writing this, she's been workshopping different ideas to me in order to get feedback on where the story's going, and I've been very vocal in suggesting that the two leads should be a thing. Lizzie tends to argue with me on this, mostly by claiming that she doesn't want Elithin, the witch's name is Elithin, by the way, to be defined by her relationships. I told her the same thing I said above, that if they get together early in the story and stay together, then that won't happen, and it generally won't interfere with the story. It's just, instead of Ellie and her friend solving mysteries, it's Ellie and her girlfriend solving mysteries. And in fact, it would help Ellie's motivations to stop the conflict, because now there's stuff in this world that she actually cares about, and she has something to call home at the end of the story. Also, it would fit really well with Lizzie's whole subverting fantasy tropes goal, since the two leads got together, but the conflict still needs to be solved, and all the usual character growth still has to happen. Hey, I know you're in a loving and supportive relationship and all, and I'm happy for you, but that doesn't mean all your problems are magically wished away. We've still got shit to do. It's not happily ever after, it's a new phase in your life. Both old school fairy tales and more modern work on myself first stories make this same mistake. They ultimately view a relationship as something that signifies the end of all your worries. Either your princess whisked you away from all your troubles, or you've only entered one once all of your troubles are gone. They both view a relationship as the end game of your entire life and character arc, and that's not a good attitude to have. It's telling of the way we view relationships and storytelling that none of these things ever occur to someone when they're listing out the problems with including romantic subplots, because we're still so wrapped up in the idea that the story must end with characters getting together and ignoring the whole romance part of romantic subplot. All the supposed problems with the romantic subplot only become problems because the author actively chooses to make it a problem. The problem isn't romantic subplots, the problem is that you're an unimaginative hack. Not you, Lizzie. Your book's great, gays or no gays. When I complained about She-Ra doing this shit and dangling gay characters in front of the viewer's face, the defense I got from everyone was, "It's a slow burn." There was that one article calling it the slow burn romance of our dreams. But guys, Every single one of these stories is a slow burn. This trope has been so fucking static for years. Don't you get tired of being told the same story over and over and over and over again? Can't we ask for a little variety? Can we dispense with the myth that there's only one way to write that is always superior in every situation? Not every show is going to be improved by being written to be binged on Netflix. And you don't have to have romantic subplots, but if you're going to have them, why can't we have something different? The slow burn is not always the most interesting, especially not when it's so overindulged. Sometimes the already married couple is more interesting. Sometimes the fourth date proposal is more interesting. Sometimes the two gay best friends who aren't actually together, but they might as well be because they're just so cute and affectionate with each other and nobody else knows how to deal is more interesting. Variety is the spice of life, and yet so many of you are insistent on eating boiled chicken. What I'm trying to say is lesbian equivalent of Gomez and Morticia. Get on it, someone.